to discuss with you application of pixel money, especially in the monitoring production process. Many of you are working in the agricultural area or agricultural application, but the talk will be general, but will give you some example of the application of pixel mapping on agricultural setting, which would be the management of agricultural production system. I think that I have to be careful of my time. I have it's 10 o'clock, or is that? So, to give you a little bit of introducing myself, I was and still am associate professor in the ITC and in the University of Denver. Although I am retired, but I still keep my relation and working with PhD student. I also used to chair the high space working group on planning and decision support system for 2 terms for 8 years from 2004-2012. And in all my career, both at ITC and also at and iSpheres, my term of reference has been to enhance the role of geoinformation in management. How can we enhance and bring the geoinformation into management decision making? And I have been doing that through research and development and modeling integration, and developing something that I call planning and decision support system. In fact, in all my career, I have been trying to make use of bringing actually the geo information into management decision. What I have planned to discuss with you today would be as follows. First, we look at the major development stages of consensus communication. That is, just quickly see what is happening. Then we go to start on pixel mapping and say, what do we mean by pixel mapping? What is it? What are the potential and what are the limitations? And then, after defining it, I would give you one example of actually application of pixel mapping in monitoring agricultural production processes. And then hopefully we'll have some time for the question and discussion. The first one on the major development stages in remote sensing application. In fact, this is what I try to distinguish three stages. On the stage one is what it, I call it cover detection. Then from cover detection, we moved into change detection. And from change detection, thank you. From change detection, we move into behavioral detection. In fact, in the first one, we mostly look at the land cover, land use, and the second one we look at the time series analysis, and in the third phase would be more process modeling and. Going through pixel mapping and smart pixels. So I would go through them one by one very briefly. First, on the cover detection, and or use detection. I'm a little bit older than maybe all of you. I started actually my remote sensing career back in 1971, when the first Earth satellite was launched. And at the time that it was launched, one of the idea was to see what is going on the ground. And in fact, one of the main purpose was in the agriculture to do crop inventory, to see how many hectares of wheat, for example, that was at the time. The LACI program, I don't know if you recall the large area crop inventory program, which the US actually they launched mainly to see how much wheat the Russian are producing. So in fact, the origin was to see what is on the ground, to detect and identify the object in the ground. What is on the ground? If we know what is it in fact, do the mapping, what is it, is that grass, is that the asphalt, is that the building, is that, what is it? And just this morning, we were discussing about the further development and how these days actually this cover mapping is happening. I saw in the University of Tehran, actually one of the good and brilliant students are really doing interesting work on the real-time detection of the buildings and in fact very advanced the stage of the cover mapping. But cover mapping, also it is very interesting and good, but it has, in fact, to bring it into the application, you need to convert it to use and see if, when you have the cover, what are these cover, where they are used. So then the land use become question. So if it is a grass, what is this? If it is tree, what is this tree? Is that an artificial tree? Is it planted? Is it natural? What is it? So then, in fact, the for application, the cover has to be converted into the land use. And of course, when we look at it also, even today, we have plenty of very advanced technique and technology, but still we have accuracy problem. I will give you a bit more information. Actually, the cover detection, the principle, the basic principle was this, that I think back in the 70s and probably still, the basic principle is that each individual object, they have got their own reflectance characteristic, the key. So if you know, for example, this is a cotton leaf, the spectral reflectance characteristic is like this. If it is a dry leaf, it looks like this. If you look at different objects in the ground, different objects, they have different characteristics. So the idea was that if we measure the characteristic and if we know this curve, so we can easily identify what is in the ground. But although this is a basic and right assumption, but in reality, it's not always like this. There are plenty of problems and there are plenty of similarities. For example, if you look at here, these are two different objects, but the reflectance characteristics are very similar. And also, if you look at one object, the objects are changing their shape in the course of time and space. If it is agricultural commodity, if it is a crop, sometimes at some stage it's a planting stage, it will grow, and when time goes on, the reflectant characteristic is changing. So, in fact, assumption that if you have this curve, then we can identify it, easily identify it, is not always true. And those of us who are familiar with the hardware and basic principle on the hardware side, we see that it is not easy to also exactly, especially from the space, clearly created this signature. So that is really subject to a lot of errors. And also when we do the field radiometry for one crop, we see that at a different stage of development, this characteristic is changing. So by time, actually, the reflectant characteristic is changing. So in fact, we cannot have one signature. In fact, at each stage of development, we have one signature. So that's why we need actually to have a many measurement in the course of development in order to be able to have a good idea of the spectral characteristic or the reflectance characteristic of each object. If you see here, at each time of development, actually we have different type of curve to measure. So with this, actually, we moved, in fact, in order to have a more application, we moved from crop detection, we moved to more change detection and time series analysis. Because when we said, okay, the objects are changing in the course of development, so we have to go through the time series analysis. So take either continuous or at least several measurements at different development stages. So the technology moves more to time series analysis of remote sensing data. And of course, when we have a time series of analysis of remote sensing data, then of course, because we have information from different stage and different time, so we can look at the change detection. So we see, for example, 1 month back, what was the behavior of the crop, how was behaving, how was looking, and how is it right now. Or if you take an annual time step, what was the area of crop, for example, last year, and how much is this year? Or in fact, go through the change detection of different landings. This change detection, in fact, what it does, in fact, it improves the accuracy of crop, accuracy of cover detection. Because when we go, I always said, in fact, in my classes and also in a number of occasions that I have been invited to talk, I said remote sensing, it used to be like this, that we take a photograph of one person and we intend to say who is this person and how he behaves or she behaves. That is, in fact, impossible thing to to ask from one picture, from a photo, we give information about the quality and performance and characteristic of a person. That is not possible. It's the same with remote sensing with objects on the earth. So yeah, we cannot, in fact, do that. If we take several pictures, when he is happy, when she is angry, when in fact perform at different important stages, we have more information, but still we cannot exactly say how he or she is behaving. It's the same with objects in the ground. Also, we do the time series analysis and improve, we collect more information about the object, but still we do not have more enough information about the behavior of the object, that how, for example, if this crop, how this crop is behaving under different circumstances, how it's reacting to drought, how it's reacting to diseases, how it's reacting to the frost, to warm and cold weather, and different on variation of environmental variables. So in fact, the change detection, which I said it is the next step of cover detection, it improves and it's at the application and improves the plant cover detection, but it still has a problem. In fact, do not give enough information about the characteristic of the objects in the ground. So in fact, we have limited application. So the next, in fact, if you look, the cover detection and change detection, in fact, they are trying to map the events. For example, if it is a flood is coming, we would like to see where are the flooded areas. If it is a drought, we would like to see where are the drought affected areas. So in fact, the focus is the mapping of the event. But in the application, sometimes we need to know more about these things. And that is actually where we go on the pixel mapping. On the pixel mapping, the objective is to model and understand the processes that are taking place at each individual pixel. What are the processes? In fact, if you look at in general, we have environmental processes. This is like desertification, like runoff, like weather. On the economic side, on each pixel, if it is, for example, agriculture area, the crop grows, how the crop is growing. If it is the irrigation application, we would like to see how the water is used in each individual pixel, how much is used. If it's the social processes, we can look at, for example, the land use change, which is very important. We like to see how the land use are changing. What are the how one land use is changing to the other? What are the processes that are, in fact, model the land use change, under which condition one land use is converted to another one. In fact, the focus here is to identify all the variables and all the parameters that are affecting certain processes. For example, if it is the process, if it is the crop growth, we would like to identify all the factors that they are affecting or impacting crop growth. if when we identified, we have to map them, the extent in time and space. When we map them, then of course we would like to model them and see the, how these parameters, this variable, they interact. In fact, we do that through the modeling, and this modeling helps us to integrate all the information that all the parameters and variables that we have identified, we integrate them through the modeling. In fact, through this modeling, we integrate all the factors that are affecting or impacting certain processes on each individual pixel that are in the ground. So, colleague of mine actually at ELIF, defined actually pixel mapping on the technology of combining satellite imagery with meteorological, geographical data to create a range of data components. In fact, to integrate, as I said, all the variables and produce information that are needed. In fact, here these are the satellite and all the input data which we do through modeling, they are integrated and generate pixel mapping, our pixel mapping, and when they are integrated, we produce what is called smart pixels. Potential and limitation. In fact, when we do to look at the pixel mapping, in fact, it complements the cover and change detection because it looks at all the variables and parameters that are affecting certain process on each pixel. Therefore, in fact, it improves greatly the detection and identification. In one example, I tell you on detection on the project that I was working on, I will present to you the result in the northern part of Iran was the rice cultivation. Mm-hmm. So to identify rice, the first thing is classification, which all of you are familiar how to classify. But with the simple classification, we don't get more than 80% accuracy. So to improve that, actually we go through time series analysis. Even time series analysis improves the accuracy few percent. But in the final stage, when we look at the behavior and understand the behavior of each rice pixel, we know how it will look like, then that will help to, in fact, increase the quality and accuracy of the rice pixel to a large extent. And in fact, in this case, we came to 92% accuracy. So the potential, actually, it improves the land cover detection, and also provide a lot more information about how each pixel behaves under different environmental and managerial situation. So that is the information that mostly needed actually in management of natural resources. But what are the difficulties and challenges? Actually, I mentioned that we do integrate the different parameters, which sometimes there are too many, through models. And as you know, models are simplifications. Models are simplification of reality. It's not the whole reality. And you know that reality is far more complex than our models. So from the other side, you know that nature is far too complex and many of the processes are not well understood, so we cannot even model them. Therefore, we use a sort of black box models, statistical models. To come up with a certain result, actually integrated model, we always forced to combine process model with statistical models, which are more experimental. This would, because of this characteristics of the model, which is the combination of physical and experimental model, they are site specific. So if I develop a model for example, for growth of certain crop in Kish, I cannot take this model exactly and take it to the north of Iran or to other places. This has to be calibrated and validated. They have to be localized. And this process of localization and calibration is very challenging task. And as I see in my experience, many people, they take the models and without good calibration, they use it and they see that the result is nonsense, and I agree. In fact, it's garbage in, garbage out. One other thing that the pixel mapping is important, I said, is the using the comprehensive models, and these comprehensive models are very much data demanding. And this data, normally they are coming from a variety of sources. If you look at the satellite, for example, we have too many satellites with too many different resolutions, from the 25 resolution to 100 centimeters resolution, and even the centimeter resolution. So, in fact, to make use of the satellite data or the remote sensing data of different spectral and temporal and the spatial resolution, it's a very challenging thing. In the course of modeling and model experiment, we have to make use of field data, which is part of the experimental and part of the statistical data. And these are very detailed and very exact data, and these are routine data. So in fact, we have a challenging task to make use of this information and integrate them in a way that they can produce the reliable data. So in fact, the challenge is how to integrate all this data and how to use the right model, how to integrate the data in time and in space and in scale. So if I want to summarize for pixel mapping, in fact, we require the integration of data from variety of sources, scales, and quality with models, which they have their source in different, they come from different disciplines. And in fact, the focus in PI mapping is more on the modeling process and process mapping. This was all too theoretical. I take the last 10-15 minutes actually to give you one example of pixel pixel mapping on a project, on a large project that we carried out in the northern part of Iran to do monitor the rice production process. This project was implemented actually through collaboration of a number of institutions, both inside the country and outside the country. But the time is limited, I don't go through it. And the area was the total Caspian Sea actually plain. If you look at the objective of the project, the objective was to actually look at the how much rice is cultivated, how the production process is going on, how much is the yield of crop of the rice on each pixel, and what is the productivity of each pixel. In fact, do continuous monitoring of production process in the whole Caspian Sea. And that was, of course, through remote sensing, GIS, ICT, and all things. If you look at the architect, the system looks overall, we have the field data, we have the field data for modeling, field data for validation, different satellite data, all they go in the model. This model produces remote sensing products, goes to quality assessment, and produce final remote sensing products. So I quickly actually go through the major processes. In fact, if you look at the processes on the modeling side, we have two important processes. One, area, how much is the area of rice, and how much each pixel, what is the yield of each pixel. So this is the yield assessment, and this is the area assessment. If you look at the area assessment, we have basically the remote sensing classification with the time series. The first part, this is the cover change, cover detection, change detection, and improved by yield data. It's the data which is actually from process modeling. And the result after quality control goes, produces final rice map. If we look at the yield, in fact the process of yield, how crop is growing. This is very important. In fact, that is the modeling side that I mentioned. In fact, here we have the different satellite data, we have weather data, we have crop property, we have a field measurement. In fact, these are used to do gross assessment, this is the field assessment, and this is how, in fact, the final yield map are produced. The yield modeling is very important. In fact, that is how it works. We call it hydrometeorological model, which, in fact, the assumption is that we say, what is the crop production? Crop production is the, we have, we know the environmental parameters, we know the crop physiology, we know the soil parameter, and all the environmental parameter. In fact, the production process is like this. We have environmental parameter, which is which is the weather parameter, soil parameter, and the crop parameter, which crops, in fact, it grows in environment. So we have, in fact, many scientists have made a model that how certain crop with certain physiological property is growing in different environment and goes through the from the first stage to the end stage. And this is, in fact, develop a mathematical model which models the production process. And this looks something like this. In fact, all the parameters, some of the parameters are coming from remote sensing, some comes from the field, and all together combined actually in the production process produce the yield factor. Or when we talk about the water consumption, in fact, we have to model how the water is consumed by a crop. So look at how these are probably artificial. I don't know if they are artificial or real, but how do they absorb water and how do they consume? And how do they behave under different environmental parameters? And see how we can do this modeling through remote sensing. In fact, this is the surface energy balance, which is a basic for actually the water consumption. If we put together all, in fact, we come up to a schema like this, which is in fact around 36 individual processes, that each process in fact has a different background, and these processes in fact are sort of mathematical, partly mathematical model, partly physical model, partly experimental model, all together working based on satellite and field information to at the end of the process we come up and say, okay, on each 25 by 20 pixel of 25 by 25 meter, how much rice is produced. If you look at the input data are two types, satellite data, field data, and climatic data. Quickly, I show here the satellite data, which are having different resolution, 250,000, 25 kilometer, up to 22 meter. So you see that when we talk about pixel mapping, integration, in fact, we have the problem of integration. How to make use of all these different satellite data. And we have the field data, actually, which these are all the field points. Very detailed information, exactly measured. We have the weather information, and then we come at the end, we combine them and put them together to come up with a certain because at the end of the day, the politician, they would like to see what is the yield on each province. This is it. They want to see, for example, the map distribution, rice yield in the resolution actually is not so nice here. I cannot show it to you. Here, for example, in one of the provinces in Gilan, what is the, we have several yield factors, we call it attainable yield, potential yield, and the yield gap. In fact, the gap, how much is produced, how much could be produced. And in fact, you can have this the point, you can, because these are all measured based on each pixel, so you can look at the potential of these characteristics per each individual pixel. And of course, when you have the pixel, you can do the aggregation on each administration unit that you require. And you present it in different way. I think I'm not sure I can make use of this, so probably I did this. This was the yield. You can look at it, that was the yield information. You can look at the area the same way. You can look at the biomass, how much biomass is produced in each individual pixel. And as a result, when you have it for each individual pixel, you can see how is it in each administration unit. You can look at the water consumption. This is the water. Actually, you can look at the on each individual pixel, you can see how much water this has required and how much has used. In fact, what is the requirement and what is the actual use, and the difference in fact is the stress, is the deficit. And this you can have per pixel, and as a result you can do all sort of, you can look at it on the chart, on the histogram, on the time series, how it has developed from the beginning to the end of the growing season. And you can do it for any administration unit that you like. You also, you can do the water productivity. Water productivity means that how much water has been used for to produce for each cubic meter of water, how much crop has produced. You can also look at the soil moisture and things like that. And when you do that also, of course, you have to look at the growing season. So in order to model this, in fact, you have to know, how, when each pixel has been cultivated, when has been harvested. So in fact, that has to also be done here. And this map shows that type of information. I think as I'm going to reaching actually 10 o'clock, I'm not going to detail of this. So you can look at also stress maps and see which pixels have been under stress by different parameters. Of course, you can look at also the weather, because one of the important base for this, you have to produce a daily map of various parameters of the weather parameters. So this, in fact, shows those parameters. I think I will pass this I will go to the last part, which is the, of course, you have to do the quality assessment when you do all your modeling. In fact, in our exercise, the reach for area is over 90% accuracy for area and 82% for yield. And this is a town level and village level. As I'm reaching actually my end, I will now stop and see if there are some questions. The point for discussion. I was told that I have 1 hour, but since we started a little bit late, so I had to pass quickly through this, but I think depend on the chair. We can see if there are some questions. We can.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sharifi, for your talk, for your review, and I learned a lot about the development in the area of remote sensing. Well, I think we have time for some questions.
Thank you for your nice and informative presentation. Actually, applications based on classification, they are supervised or unsupervised applications, and they have fixed parameters, some of them. But you came out with many different parameters in this actually presentation. So I'd like to know what kind of applications you use for actually discussing the classification.
What do you mean by application?
I mean the software or programming.
That is a good question. In fact, in my talk, on the general talk, I said one of the challenges in this type of exercise is the models. We have crop simulation models. The models, there are many, actually. I always say there are, thanks God, that we have thousands of scientists who have nothing to do except doing research and producing models. And all these models are good. But good for what? Good for that particular area that they have been developed. So it is not something that we take a model, for example, have been developed in Wageningen. I take it and here and directly use it. Because this model, some of it is process, for example, based on process of how crop make use of the environmental parameter and the nutrient and convert it to dry matter. That is physical, but part of it is experimental. So we don't know exactly how this is behaving. In Kish environment, how it is behaving in Netherlands environment. So all these models, in fact, they make sense if the user knows the basic principle of this. It is not like neural network or all this the machine learning program that you, in fact, give your right to the machine to decide for you. In fact, you have to know the process and you have to go through a very elaborate calibration and validation process. For example, this I mentioned here, this surface energy balance. Surface energy balance, SEBAL, probably some of you have heard of it. A colleague of mine, Wim Bastiansen, developed this SEBAL program. This SEBAL program is making use of the satellite data to measure the crop evapotranspiration, how much plant is using water. But this is, I had a colleague, a professor actually at ITC, he said, I don't know, when I use this program, I get nonsense. When the Wim is using the program, he's getting a beautiful result. So I do not know. In fact, the reason is the guy who has developed it, he knows, in fact, all the bottom, and they know how to calibrate it, and the other doesn't. So
user bias.
Yeah, in fact, these models are, there are many models available, but the art is to do the right calibration and the validation process. So in fact, it is not, the program, if you say, okay, there are a number of public domain things, but without the proper validation and calibration, they cannot be. And in fact, they make use of plenty. In fact, it is the art here is to integrate the satellite data of, for example, resolution of 25 kilometers with 22 meter calibration, to 22 meter resolution. So you have this range. And there are plenty of techniques involved, and of course, at each stage you introduce a thin error which you have to be careful. But it's possible.
My questions are biomass related questions. You adapted normalized difference vegetation index to derive biomass, or you adapt some other techniques to derive biomass? Is it volume or it is surface?
Actually, the end product is kilogram per hectare. So how much biomass is produced, how many kilograms biomass is produced per hectare on each individual piece, or how much yield this biomass has to be converted to the paddy, to the rice. How much rice, how many kilograms of rice has been produced per hectare in each individual piece. That is the end product. And also how much water is used per hectare in each individual pixel. How much is required, how much is used. So the actual and potential. In fact, that is very important in this type of exercise for water management, because you know how much water is required. And then you know how much water is used. The difference, in fact, is the stress. So the crop needed so much and received so much. So that difference is the stress.
Thank you, Professor. I have a question to clarify your method. You have used different satellite data at different spatial resolution. And you have also introduced a concept of pixel mapping, where exactly auxiliary data is getting integrated. So my question is, so you create smart pixels and you apply a crop model to estimate the crop area and yield. Is that what you did, or the model is applied to create this smart pixels and then you apply a classification to? I'm not clear on that.
Yeah, okay. Excellent. Very good question. Actually, to work the process is like this. If the objective is to understand how production process works, how rice production is taking place. So first we have to understand how this production process is taking place. That means, for example, what are the elements, what are the major processes? The major process is photosynthesis. What is photosynthesis? Photosynthesis, in fact, is the crop takes the CO2 of air with some water from ground and some nutrients from the ground, with the energy coming from the sun, converted to biomass. So this is the basic principle. Okay, so if we know this process, then we have to see, for example, the energy. How to put the input of energy in this process. So that you have to look at the radiation, how much the radiation is coming and reaching the ground, the crop. How much, which part of the crop is absorbing this energy? It's the leaves. So you have to see how much the leaf is produced, how this energy is absorbed. So you have to, in fact, make a model, and when you make this model, then try to put the inputs from different satellites. Yeah? So first you build up your process and the requirement, data requirement, and then go and look at how to provide this input data from different satellites. Some of it from this satellite, some of it from the other satellite, some of it from the other satellite, and make this combination to fulfill the requirement of actually the production process at each individual pixel.
So that's where the ET also, I mean, that,
yeah,
so
that is ET as well as the biomass, as well as the yield.
So these are all inputs to your model.
Yeah.
It's a smart pixel result.
Yes. Actually, the smart pixel, in fact, is the result that is a pixel which has actually all the information related to that process of the pixel. In fact, on this exercise, we have 1800 layers.
Okay.
Each layer, in fact, is showing one parameter or one factor related to production process. So, in fact, the smart pixel, in fact, the smart process which integrates all these things and gives out information that the decision maker or manager they require, and that is the, for example, the yield and the stress and things like that.
That's
yeah, you mentioned now these very coarse pixels and the Landsat at the 30 meter pixel level. And we see nowadays in agriculture that precision agriculture is now getting, or is already a big topic. What do you think about now all your different resolutions on the satellites? Are they still helpful for precision agriculture? Because they are now interested to see the diseases not only on the hectare level, they want to see it on the field level. And they want to spray you know, only this chemical at this location and not everywhere the same chemicals and so on. So is it, what will be the way? Go to very high resolution satellites now on the meter or sub-meter levels in future, or just change, let's say, to topics like UAV flights, or what will be the future? Because I believe these great models which you develop with thousands of parameters which fit now exactly for the north of Iran will not fit for precision agriculture, I think.
Excellent question. Actually, now I have a PhD student working on a plant level. Because if you like to see this on each individual plant. And of course, the important plants are trees. So we are working actually on the tree level. And okay, you know, we have the technology push. Of course, UAV is coming, and UAV is also producing a lot of detail. That with my background, actually, I've been involved in remote sensing actually since 1971, actually, from the Earth's. Yes, a little bit old. But some of this really we don't need, but the user likes to have it. I give you an example. In Iran, we have in the south, we have the sugarcane factories, the very large agro-industrial complexes, which it, in fact, the farm size is 2 hectares. 2 hectares of, when they grow, it's around 3 meters high. I think satellite, the Landsat, they are far more than enough for this type of application. But the client, they're talking to me and they say, okay, we like to have UAV. They like to have a UAV system which flows over the field and give them far more detailed information. In fact, for experiment, I think for research, and we don't know in the future what comes in future. What we have been doing here, we have plenty of public domain satellite information, which are available any part of the world, which is not used. And it has a potential to be used like this. In fact, here, the only one satellite, commercial satellite data, the 22 meters data, that is what we purchase. The rest is all public domain. And I think that is good enough. Of course, if somebody wants to go in, they want to do on the farm management, on each individual farm, and because he wants to focus on that, I think, then of course the models are more or less the same, the basic principles are the same, but the input data are more detail. For example, if you have, for example, 100 hectares land and you want to do precision agriculture, you use UAV instead of using Landsat, or you use other commercial satellite, the others, or anything else. So you BMC, you can fly with UAV and in fact, I am also, I have not used UAV, and I was just talking on the breakfast. Perhaps we can do one exercise with the University of Tehran using UAV. Mainly, in my mind, for calibration rather than for cruising. Yeah, so. But what future brings, I think, is. I think UAV is future.
Okay, thank you.